Imagine somebody pulling a gun on you, you calling the police, and the person who pulled the gun on you all of a sudden has on a uniform now and is the police responding to your 911 call. That's exactly what happened to this individual who had a gun pulled out on him by an off-duty cop. Let's put his picture for a mass. His name is Jason. Jason Leonor. So let me give you some background to this. An off-duty cop pulled out a gun on a man during a road rage incident. Goes on duty. The cop then goes on duty to pull him over afterwards and then tries to cover it up with his colleagues. The case involves that man right there. He's the victim, 33-year-old Hispanic Black male. This is an incident that occurred April 2021. A lot of twists and turns here. When a man driving a green Honda pulled a gun on him during a traffic dispute, according to the Globe. Let me give a big shout out to the Globe, because if it had not been for their investigation, nobody would have believed this young brother, because the irony is so extreme. The man who pulled the gun on him turned out to be an off-duty transit cop named Jacob Green. And within moments, he allegedly began to conspire to cover up the event, according to police records and a search warrant affidavit obtained by the Globe. After the initial encounter, both men continued driving toward Mattapan. Green radioed another officer to pull Leonor over. All right, it gets worse, according to the search warrant affidavit. Then, back in uniform, walked to Leonor's driver's side window. Despite Green's allegation that Leonor drove dangerously and accosted him in traffic, Green cited him only for marked lanes violation, a citation that obviously was ultimately thrown out. So what do you have so far? You have a cop pulls out a gun on the citizen, he's off duty. The citizen decides to call 911. What does the cop do? The cop then goes on duty, radios his buddy, hey, pull this guy over. His buddy actually initially responds, interacts with the young man, and then the off duty, now on duty cop decides to approach the young man as well. Green, a 22-year veteran of the Transit Police Department, returned to the station and wrote two police reports. Once again, obtained by the Globe, saying that when Leonor initially approached his car, he had grabbed his gun, but kept it on his lap. And within 2 hours of the incident, he started calling and texting another transit police officer named Kevin Davis, who then came forward to claim he witnessed the whole thing from his car while being off duty. Bull. All right, so let's go to the DA. Let's put a picture up. The Suffolk DA, district attorney at the time, Rachel Rollins, launched an investigation. Now, this is where it gets interesting, even more so. Transit police officials themselves found the incident troubling and had brought the matter to the DA. In short order, her office tapped a prosecutor from the special prosecutions unit to oversee the case. And a transit police investigator obtained a search warrant for Green's and Davis's phones. But then this DA left the prosecutor's office to become the US attorney for Massachusetts earlier this year. So what happens to the investigation? Under the current DA, who is Kevin Hayden, let's put up a picture of Kevin, the case has stalled out. And an attorney for Green has claimed that the DA's office told him that the case was over and done with. GOP Governor Charlie Baker appointed Hayden, who was running in the September 6th Democratic primary. So behind the scenes, Hayden ushered in changes that compounded the issue. Let me get into that. Hayden hiring as his first assistant Kevin Mullen, a former prosecutor and defense attorney who has represented troubled law enforcement officers and is the nephew of a retired Boston police superintendent. The DA's special prosecutions unit, which is often charged with prosecuting law enforcement officials, lost nearly all of its staff in the transition, okay? Virtually everybody. It's three prosecutors left this spring, and Hayden has not yet filled those positions. Isn't that something? Once again, law enforcement operating in a way that's antithetical to the community, that's adversarial to transparency, that does not make sense to individuals who are in position to benefit from an actual investigation. The young man at the center of this, he was done wrong. Criminal activity happened against him. There was a cover up. You have corrupt cops. You have cops who are willing to engage in criminal activity in order to cover up a damn traffic dispute. If they're willing to do this to cover up a traffic dispute, what else do you think they'll do? What else do you think they have done? None of this stuff is ever linear. It is always multifaceted. All right, Attorney Lawrence, thoughts here.
Without a doubt, I think you're absolutely right in that this isn't the first time and it damn sure won't be the last, because there is not sufficient accountability. As you have acknowledged, the Globe really deserves considerable credit for this, for unearthing this and bringing it to light and seeing how all of these pieces are, they're all working and operating together to silence a man who was the victim in this situation. And it really speaks to the abuses of power that go on and that are continued to be perpetuated because you have people within the system who are operating it and who are doing favors for each other and looking out for each other so that there is no accountability whatsoever. And at the end of the day, it is us, we the people, who ultimately end up suffering. Yet we are also the ones who are, you know, paying for their wages, who are taking care of these people. So there just needs to be better accountability and also greater transparency, because situations like this should never happen.
The reality is so diabolical when you consider the facts. And here's the fact, we are forced to pay for our own oppression. Our tax dollars go to individuals who would prefer to oppress us rather than liberate us. All right.